To mark St David's Day, Pam Rhodes joins the people of Llanberis in North Wales to sing hymns in honour of their national saint. And you can see that in Village Praise this evening here on BBC One at 6:25. Now, news, views and issues affecting those with hearing difficulties in our magazine programme, See Here.
Hello. Where do you go to really let your hair down and be yourself? Particularly if you're young and partially deaf, and usually try to disguise your deafness when you're out on the town with your hearing friends. This report is from Maria Butcher, who works for Hearing Concern and runs the youth section known as Yahoo.
I was first diagnosed with having a hearing loss. It wasn't until I was 23 that I actually became profoundly deaf. Most of the time my life has spent being brought up in the hearing world. I had a lot of hearing friends, but they didn't always understand the problem about deafness. That was when I started coming into Covent Garden to meet with other partially deaf young people. Before, they used to feel like that I was the only partially deaf young person that could actually speak. You know it's up to you. I think it's only fair. Why doesn't her to do? Apologize to her. Because she loves you. And you know that can't be bad. She loves you. It took me a long time to admit to myself that I had a hearing loss. In fact, in the past, I would rather have died than actually tell anyone that I was deaf. The problem is, when you can speak perfectly well, people assume that you've got normal hearing. It was the wrong thing to do. I wasted so much time trying to be a hearing person. I know how difficult it is for partially deaf young people to get together. Maybe you've tried going to a deaf club, but you'll soon realise that sign language can be a barrier as well to communication. But you can do something about that now. Meeting other people with a hearing loss is your most important step. It builds up your confidence because you don't have to worry about not being able to hear. We're all in the same boat here.
My friend, my toy boy.
I went out a lot with hearing friends. I go to the pubs and they'd all be talking away to each other. They'd have a great time. They'd be making jokes and laughing. And I couldn't see what they were laughing at, but I'd make out that I could see what they were laughing at and make out that I was laughing as well. But really, I didn't understand why I was laughing.
It took me about 8 years to find a hard of hearing club. I feel much more relaxed here. And when I bring my husband here, he's hearing the hard of hearing people. I accept him, there's no problem. They welcome him. But with the deaf club, they don't welcome him because he doesn't sign language or speak different.
If someone's deaf and you've got someone who's hearing, and the hearing people always seem to dominate a deaf person, it is strange. There's no doubt about it. But I just went in, was relaxed, never tried to push myself over, and eventually they just accepted me as who I am.
We say I'm profoundly deaf, but I think I'm more like a hard of hearing person, because I mix with hard of hearing people. I'm not very good at sign language, so it makes me more, I find it more difficult to mix with deaf people.
Last year was my first time meeting anybody that was deaf, hard of hearing, so.
Messenger.
Yeah.
Just packing.
Post.
Post.
Yeah, put all the posts.
And we know, most of
them. I'm from a hearing family and was never taught sign language.
Not that much.
So I don't know much, so I lip read. Now, I've been brought up with a hearing family, so I'm used to hearing people, but I am interested in learning to sign. Now, I'm stone deaf, and the others are partially hearing, so obviously we're different. It's difficult for me to lip read, but I am learning. I mean, they're teaching me, and they know what it's like for me to sign, and I'm trying to teach them some sign language. We're good friends, we understand each other.
Come along every 3 weeks.
Well, with hearing girls, there's a sort of barrier. It's what I call a time limit with the patients that hearing girls have.
At the beginning?
I mean, at the beginning it's all right, but as time goes on, hearing girls usually get impatient with a deaf person. And that's why the relationships don't work.
Well, I didn't specifically look for a person with a hearing loss, but I think if you've got the same common interest, being hard of hearing, I think it's a lot easier to develop a stronger relationship.
I came here for the first time about 3 weeks ago, and everyone's so friendly, incredibly friendly, and I feel sort of like part of the crowd.
It was a huge improvement on my life. It gave me confidence that I didn't have before. It made me much more relaxed. It made me come out of myself. I didn't do that before. I met my girlfriend as well.
Now, if you want more information on clubs in your area, contact Maria at this address. Hearing Concern, 7 to 11 Armstrong Road, London W3, 7JL. That's Hearing Concern, 7 to 11 Armstrong Road, London W3, 7JL. There's been a long campaign to get anti-discrimination laws passed in this country. Laws to make discrimination against disabled people illegal in employment, in housing, on transport, at leisure, and many other areas. But the campaign suffered a setback a week ago. The latest attempt to get a bill through Parliament, and so make a new law, was blocked by the government amid angry protests from supporters. This Civil Rights Disabled Persons Bill had already passed successfully through the House of Lords, but it was stopped from getting a second reading in the House of Commons when a Conservative MP, Andrew McKay, shouted, "Object." That was all that was needed under the rules of Parliament.
Civil Rights Disabled Persons Bill, Lord, second reading.
Question is, the bill be read a second time. As many as that opinion? Sorry.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Objection taken. Second reading what day?
MPs from all parties had supported the bill, but Nicholas Scott, Minister for Disabled People, said it was too wide-ranging and too expensive for government and business to adopt. And so it didn't get any further. A year ago, we showed you on See Here deaf people lobbying in support of Alf Morris's civil rights bill, almost identical to the one that failed last week. We want the same rights as have been achieved by sex and race legislation. But it's always been the same, hasn't it? And I want to know that we're actually going to achieve something this time. I doubt it somehow. They were right to be pessimistic. But last week's failure made MPs and campaigning groups very angry. It was described as a kick in the teeth for disabled people. Earlier, Alf Morris had presented a petition which he said had the support of millions of people. He talked of anguish and anger among 6.5 million people with disabilities. Nicola Scott says he will talk to the All-Party Group on Disability in Parliament to take a fresh look at legislation. Now, Jack, you're the joint chair of the Parliamentary All-Party Group on Disability. Can you tell us why this MP killed the bill?
Well, because although MPs of all parties supported the bill, he was representing the government. And the government said, we don't want this bill, and he used that procedure to kill it.
So in that case, is there no point in can carry on? Will the bill now finish? Is it dead?
Well, what happened really is that a few days before that bill was presented to Parliament, a small group of us saw the Prime Minister and asked him to support the bill. And the Prime Minister was both frank and friendly. He was frank and he said, we can't accept this bill because of the enormous financial implications. He was friendly because he said, afterwards, if you get together with the Minister for Disabled People, you can prepare a bill to avoid discrimination against disabled people without the great financial implications. And so we're going to do just that.
So do you think it's true that it really is going to be very expensive if that bill had passed?
Well, it can be expensive. If you think in terms of employment and in terms of making every bus accessible, every taxi accessible, a lift in every underground, it can be expensive. But disabled people want rights, and some of them need not be expensive. But what we will do now is prepare a bill without massive expenditure, although some will be required. And my committee will get together with Nicola Scott, the Minister, and prepare a new bill, and that gives us great hope for the future.
Jack, thank you very much. We can all write to our MPs to continue the campaign. Carol.
The environment is a hot topic for schools across the country. As part of the national curriculum, many schools are creating and learning to manage their own nature areas. Hollybush School in South Wales is planting a woodland area and planning a site for a pond. It all came out of a trip to the National Garden Festival last summer. On a typical Welsh summer's day, a group of children from Hollybush School went to Ebervale. A Welsh valley transformed from a polluted, disused steelworks to a world of natural lakes and fantasy gardens.
Thank you.
A road train delivers the children to the Wetlands Discovery Centre, which is the open-air classroom for a bit of hands-on environmental study.
Yeah, leave it in there. Let's have a look and see what we've got. Right, come out. Put it in here. Now turn it upside down and wash it off in the water.
Something in yours? Let's have a look.
No, they're all underneath the water. Oh, look at that. We can see really closely now.
It's a big water boatman. Looks as if he's got a pair of oars.
Right. In the water. Did you enjoy your pond dipping? Yes, you've caught lots of different creatures, haven't you? Shall we have a look and see what sort of things you caught? Yeah? Okay, we've caught some water snails. Water boatmen here. This is very special. You've caught a dragonfly nymph. And they will turn into beautiful dragonflies later on. We've also got some mayfly nymphs. And they show us that we have got very clean water in our ponds. So hopefully, in a few months' time, after you've dug your pond, you'll have some of these sorts of creatures, like we have here today. Yes?
After this trip, the pupils were full of enthusiasm for building their own nature area.
It would be a good idea to have a conservation area in school. Over there, next year, we're going to start digging a pond. But here, we are making a woodland. Okay, planting lots of different trees. Okay? And you are going to carry on helping the children who have started this work. Okay? We started last week.
This tree is called a holly bush. Everyone's planting trees and hopefully they'll grow. I've been working with a girl who helped me to dig, plant, and stamp down the soil.
We planted hazel, holly, ashes, willow trees.
Mrs. that's deep enough for the tree there.
Well, good luck. We shall keep in touch with the school and their conservation project.
Well, today we can announce the winner of Hearing Concerns competition to find the clearest speaker on television. The idea behind the contest was to highlight the needs of lip-reading viewers, and you sent in many different views. Let me tell you first who was third and who was second. In fact, there was a tie for third place between newsreaders Anna Ford, Alice Stewart and Trevor MacDonald. The runner-up was Martin Lewis of BBC News. But the winner was John Sushai of ITN.
From ITN headquarters, the early evening news with John Sushai.
Hello, the government signalled the end of the line for British Rail today and introduced the era of privatisation. The track itself will be run by one body, individual services and routes by other companies. It'll be introduced bit by bit, but the government made clear what it eventually wants, 100% privatisation for the whole rail system.
Congratulations, John.
Thank you very
much. Now, with us is Bill Shield, the chair of Hearing Concern, to present you with the award, Bill.
Just me very great pleasure in presenting you with this certificate as the winner of Hearing Sound Competition to find the clearest speaker on television.
Thank you very much indeed.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And the best wishes for the future.
Thank you very much.
Well, John, but were you aware of this award, or was it a total surprise to you?
I have to say, Jack, it did come as a total surprise. I didn't know about the competition. And so when I received a phone call telling me I'd won it, I was absolutely dumbfounded and delighted, delighted.
Now, when you were reading the news, you have a very big audience and you were aware of that. Are you aware at all of special interest groups like deaf people, or are you too preoccupied with the news?
It's not a question of being too preoccupied, but there is an infinite range of people watching the television. They may be university professors to bus drivers. They may be hearing impaired to who knows what. So what one tries to do is always steer a middle course and address a completely average person, just one person. As somebody once said, reading the news is reading to one person several million times. So I don't make any special concessions. I'm not especially aware of who I'm talking to. I just try to read to the completely average person.
What do you think can be done to get more people in television to speak clearly?
Well, I shall certainly play my part by telling all my colleagues how important it is, because this has taught me that there are a lot of people out there, I believe it's 8 million people or more, with hearing difficulties, and that is a very large number of people, and it requires very little effort on a broadcaster's part to make his or her speech just that little bit more comprehensible. So I shall do my part.
John, thank you very much, and congratulations again.
Thank you, Jack.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Book a holiday for just £5 deposit. When this offer appeared in the window of Lund Polly, the travel agent, it looked like a bargain too good to miss. That's what Mr. and Mrs. Ledsam of Birmingham thought when they booked up last September for a fortnight in Greece with their children and some friends. We had a letter from Mrs. Ledsam's mother, Mrs. West, explaining what happened next. The Ledsams paid over the £5 each, plus £70.80 compulsory holiday insurance cover. Later, they decided they couldn't afford to go away on holiday, so they went back to Lund Polly to cancel the booking. That's where they got a shock. Lund Polly told them that they owed another £165.
That's interesting. They'd handed over £5 each, plus insurance. Why did they then owe another £165 when they didn't want the holiday?
Well, because the £5 special offer didn't cover the whole cost of the holiday deposit. It was just a down payment at an attractive price. When the Ledsams booked, they had to sign a form called a low deposit indemnity, which actually made them liable for the rest of the deposit if they cancelled. But Mr. and Mrs. Ledsam didn't realise this.
So they had discussions and then signed this form. Why did they not realise what they'd agreed to?
Communication between Mr. and Mrs. Ledsam and the travel agent was by writing down on paper. Now, as most of you will know, this can be slow, and often the full information doesn't get across. Obviously, there was a misunderstanding.
So what happened next?
Well, Lund Polly told the Ledsams to pay up the £165, or they would be passed over to the debt collection department. Mrs. West wrote to Lund Polly on her daughter's behalf, explaining about the communication problems. They replied, saying they were sorry about the situation, stating why the money had to be paid and saying that in their opinion, the sales consultant had made matters as clear as possible when she wrote down all of the holiday information.
I'm still not clear why they had to pay the extra £165. Couldn't Lon Polly have cancelled the deposit when they realised there'd been a misunderstanding?
See here contacted ABTA, the Association of British Travel Agents, to find out the legal situation. Now, they said that Lon Polly are entitled to get their money. By law, the travel agents must pay the full amount of the deposit to the tour operators at the time of a booking. So, in effect, the travel agent is loaning the money to the customer until he pays up. So Lon Polly had already paid up front to Air Tours, the holiday company, and wanted to get their money back from the Ledsons. And most holiday companies treat the deposit as unreturnable if you change your mind.
So did Mr. and Mrs. Ledson have to pay the £165?
Well, yes. Once you've signed a contract, there's not much more you can do. The contract that the couple signed is a legal document, even though they say they didn't have full access to the small print they were signing.
So what's going to happen to the Ledsons?
Well, Mrs. West has agreed to pay off the debt at £5 a month. Meanwhile, Lon Polly have arranged with Air Tours that if they can resell the holiday, they will refund the deposit. We asked Lon Polly for a statement. They said,
Lon Polly regrets any misunderstandings about the terms and conditions of the low deposit offer. We are confident, however, that the staff explained in full all details of the agreement and that Lon Polly's low deposit indemnity form, signed by Mr. and Mrs. Ledson, clearly states the customer's responsibilities. It is important to Lon Polly that customers receive the best service possible, and we invest heavily in staff training to ensure this.
Well, perhaps deaf awareness training is something they will be able to introduce in the future, if they're not doing it already.
Well, yes, that's obviously very important, this deaf awareness training, because once they've got that with their staff, then this sort of thing probably won't happen again.
That's right.
Thank you, Carol. So the message seems to be, look before you book, and don't expect something for nothing. See you next week for another magazine edition. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.